Jim, there is 1,001 things I'd like to talk to you about, but time is tight tonight. Let's talk about this venue and what it means to you, first of all, because I gather you were here at the famous No Sleep Till Hammersmith Motorhead show, right?
Yes.
Okay, so put us in the picture of that night.
Oh, I wish I could remember that whole thing. it was, I had met Lemmy that summer. This was 1980, the first year that we were here. And he was one of the original gang that came to see the Stray Cats because he's a rockabilly boy. And we just maintained a friendship always 100 years later. And he had come to our gigs. And so it's his gig tonight. I think they were on some UK tour. And I think this was the last show or last two shows. Hammersmith, I think there were two nights maybe.
Right.
For Motorhead.
And, what, and they both made the record, did they?
Yeah, I think it might be a compilation. I'm not sure of the exact history of that. But, you know, with him, it was probably true. He probably, you know, slept at, you know, Liverpool and didn't sleep again until Hammersmith. So, yeah, I do remember being at it, and I do remember it, you know, of course, being loud and him saying something like, you know, I'm so happy I'll be the last thing you hear before you go deaf to the audience. And then it became, I think, the first rock live album to ever go to number one, I think.
Yeah, I think you're right.
So at the time, you never know. Things are historic until...
Do you not? Even with something like a Motorhead or a Clash or a...
I don't...
I guess because there was so much of it at that time, wasn't there? Every band was killing.
And it's kind of what you did that day.
I'm going to
Lemmy's gig tonight. Okay. But I always knew those two people you just said, Motorhead or The Clash, I always knew how good it was and like happy to be there. I saw The Clash 20 times. They had a good run, I remember. Maybe that year or maybe the right after that at the Lyceum. Like they did like 3-4 nights in a row. And I just went every night with the Derek, the guy that used to be the, you know, the driver for the Stray Cats. It was one of, I think it might have been the tour that had the graffiti, the guy behind them when they were doing it. And it was a lot like this Hammersmith Odeon, Lyceum. You pretty much just knew where to go and you turned up at the back of it, like here.
Yeah.
And there's the guy in the little guard booth and he knows, oh, okay, that guy. And you just went in.
It no was need for passes. Much, like, yeah.
Yeah, it's probably still like that if you know the guy to open up the gate. It's still, and if you go around enough and you're nice to everybody, I'm sure, you know, it's still that way.
Do you still feel a connection with London? Does it still feel like a home from home to you?
Positively. Jenny and I were just talking. If I had to live anywhere, I would be here. It's you know, great, especially in the in Chelsea. And London was to me the, you know, still is. It's the greatest. If it didn't rain every day, I would live here.
Although today's like freakishly hot.
Yeah. But it always lures me in London. I think I was here last year in August whenever Jenny and I had a couple of shows. It was nice. And I think, what do I live in London? Okay. And then
the rain
if you
starts
stay long
in.
Enough, it's like cold in July and raining. So, no, but I love it here. And they accepted us when we were trying to find some place to accept us. And it'll always be very special to me. And I know the others feel the same way too. It's positively. Yeah, I mean, it's a special place. Where else could it really happen? I think if you're a band still, I think it holds true. I think you have to come here and make it.
You came here with literally nothing, right? No plans, no job, no cash.
Yeah, I'm still sleeping at someone else's house. I just friends now.
Yeah. I mean, you came over here like
a friend
right
of mine that I've known all those years too.
At the right time, didn't you? Like in terms of music and culture, like it was just exploding.
There's luckily, I think there's no way to really know that part. We were so young, and we just knew that we had to go somewhere. We had the NME, and it had King's Road on there, and there's cool people there. I didn't know particularly who anybody was. We just knew there were Teds here, and you were allowed to wear a spiky belt walking down the street, not have a hassle over it, and have, you know, have some color in your hair. So we just knew that London was cool. I didn't know what it was going to be. I thought everyone was going to be Ringo or you know, Prince Charles. I didn't know the difference.
Everyone lives in the castle.
I kind of thought, and we just thought it was Hard Day's Night. Everything was going to be like that. So in a funny way, it did turn out that way, but there was no way of knowing what scene was going to happen, and there was a hole in the culture right now that needed to be plugged, and there was a relevance between punk rock and the oncoming onset of, like, there was no way of knowing any of that. I think a lot of that we kind of caused our own luck.
Yeah.
Because we
came over, and the scene was so small as well, wasn't it? So everyone knew everyone. And
yeah. There was a little bit of a rockabilly, maybe Teddy Boys, but I don't think that there was what it is now. There wasn't 4,000 of them to put in Hammersmith Odeon, that much I know. There was a very small amount of punk rockers who were melding into rockabilly. It was the next thing, and punk rock was kind of over, but there was a certain amount of people that still liked to dress up, and there was a connection between rockabilly and punk rock always.
Were there no Teds in New York then at that time?
No, I didn't even really know any Teds in London when we first came. You know, we heard about it. It was more of a legendary thing to us, because we had that book, The Teds. I still have my copy of it.
Yeah.
For Brian and me, it was like everything that, you know, we thought everyone was going to be like that. It's England. We didn't really know that there was like, there was the south of England and then there was the north of England. We didn't quite understand the whole thing. It was just everyone there is a Ted. We didn't quite get it all. There wasn't anyone in New York like that, no. We had just got those books, really, and we were slowly discovering rockabilly from an old record store that the guy wasn't a Ted who owned the record store. It was just some guy that had a record store that sold a few of those records, and a lot of them were from England. The Charlie label and the Ace label, and a lot of those reissues of American labels. Like, we had the Imperial Rockabilly, I remember the purple cover, the MGM Rockabilly that had the Leo the Lion on it. We had the Star Day Dixie, and we had the Charlie that were all released on Charlie. They were all American labels that were out of print that this guy from England, Ted Carroll was his name, he had Ace Records, and he had a Charlie small imprint, and I guess they bought up those old catalogs and made, and that's how we got them. So it was American music from an English label coming back to America, and everything that we thought was cool kind of came from England, except the actual music.
It was always that interesting transatlantic relationship, wasn't it, with blues coming over here and then, you know, British beat music going back
and
over
we
to the States.
Had the Clash, I didn't really know that well. We had the Sex Pistols album. And Glenn was here.
Glenn
last
was
night.
Last night. Yeah. Bumped into the toilet. Yeah. All right, Glenn.
There you have it. And I think we had not the whole album, but a few of the Neat. We had heard that. We didn't really know that much because we were still kind of young, and you know, records were $20 or whatever the imports were. We didn't have that much to go by, so much, but we knew something was in England because we had the Sex Pistols, and we had a couple copies of NME that they would sell 8 weeks later at the secondhand record store. So we had that, and we had the rockabilly. We had Gene Vincent's second album. We had the Sex Pistols. We had some copies of the NME, and that's pretty much what we based it all on.
Yeah. Isn't it interesting? Because the roadmap was always there, and you know, it was quite clear that the Stones, the Beatles, all those bands, where they were drawing their influences from. But obviously, fast track 15 years, when punk was happening, no one apart from you guys at that time initially was riffing on that old school rock and roll, R&B. It's weird, isn't it?
I don't know if you had to be American to do it or not. And we were from New York, so we didn't know anything about the south of the U.S. It was TV. It wasn't anything.
Yeah, like a foreign
any
country,
live
basically.
Experience. But we loved it. We really loved the whole. We kind of loved the concept of everything in England. Everyone was Ted's on King's Road. And we also liked the
down
theory
on Brighton Beach,
of
like,
everyone in USA in the South was Jethro from the Beverly Hillbillies. Like, we wanted to think those two things. Like, everyone's a hillbilly and everyone's a Teddy Boy.
Yeah. Right?
So then you learn the reality of it all is that still just like when 10th of 1% of 1 billionth of everyone is right?
Yeah.
So, but we were never interested in being a cult thing or like a niche thing. It really wasn't you just make the best record you can. You do the best gig you can. We didn't really, now I think it's a funny thing, whereas you almost, like you can shoot for cult status. Like, I want to be a, you know, rockabilly legend, or, you know, I want to be a punk rock legend. I think you can kind of target it more. Now, when we started, the only way to make a record was to get a record deal. The only way to play for a lot of people was to make a following. Or so there wasn't any, I don't want to say shortcut, but there was no other way to do it.
Play a lot of shows, get good, get in front of the right people. Huh. And was it Dave Edmonds who produced your first record?
Yes, and Edmonds, I like to compare the whole thing to Sam Phillips, not us to Elvis so much, but like, Edmonds was looking for someone like us. He had the sound in his head since the 60s, and we didn't know him. I kind of heard I Hear You Knocking. We knew a little bit about it, but not that much. I didn't have all Dave Edmonds albums like I do now. So he had a sound in his head of like a modern rockabilly, the same way as Sam had an idea in his head of how to mix those old R&B records with the hillbilly records, and he didn't really have the right until he met Elvis Presley. Dave had a similar thing, because he'd been making these kind of records since the 60s, which now I know, I didn't know then, and we didn't really know that much to... and these... They, meaning those British guys from a certain age, came to see the shows. Like Lemmy, like Jeff Beck was here last night. Like those guys came to see us play. And I didn't even know the connection to it. Like Lee and I were in a band. We were trying to learn Freeway Jam the year before that. And like, well, Dave Edmonds, I remember the song on the radio, but it doesn't, they didn't look rockabilly, right? So I didn't know the difference so much. Now, and that was part of my learning process, that, oh yeah, okay, Jeff Beck like Gene Vincent. Now I get it. Like we didn't know. I didn't know. We just loved that music and were trying to sound like, you know, Buddy Holly and the Crickets' first album and the second Gene Vincent. That's all I knew that we were trying to do. And luckily, I was still young and I was moldable, and I started to realize this, how Jeff Beck likes the Stray Cats and how Dave Edmonds wants to produce it, and they think it's a good idea. They meaning that everything was happening kind of at the same time, where there was some interest from labels, and the Mick Jagger and Keith Richards were coming to the shows and they wanted to do it, but it was very hard to get them pinned down. So we start a record next week, because we were still a bit in flux. We were kind of the talk of the town playing clubs, but we still had nowhere to live particularly. We didn't have any money.
Yeah.
It was
that
just
classic
still
story.
Just the three of us with, you know, where do we go now? Everyone likes us. Okay, maybe we can sleep at their house tonight. So we needed something that was going to happen relatively quickly. And Edmonds was there. He met the you know, the right person at the right record company. It was all in live time. You know, we had a couple of meetings all, you know, happening at once. And the guy from Arista was there the same night that Dave was. We'll sign tomorrow. I'll produce tomorrow. Okay, let's go. And we kind of went in within a day or so and did Runaway Boys. That was the... where it comes into it, what you said before is, made me think of this whole thing, was you have to play a lot. Before we did this at a pub, you just don't walk in there and Jeff Beck likes it, you know, you're just all of a sudden good at it. We played in New York for over a year, four sets a night, five nights a week for a year. So when you come and just play half an hour, here you go, boom.
Easy, right?
Yeah.
You own those chops.
We were good at it. So so that's the main thing. And I... there's really, to me, no way around that. You just got to do it all the time. And I think that comes across.
Do you think those days are gone of the, you know, up-and-coming band playing several sets a night, getting incredibly good live? It seems to me now that it's just like, go.
Yeah. I think that part of it is still possible because there are bands out there playing. What I do think is not going to happen again is that I don't think that you can be popular without knowing it. Like we were selling imports back in the States and it was big in France and we didn't know it, kind of thing. I don't think that can happen again because now there's so much information that everybody knows everything right away. But I do think that there's still a spot for people who go out and, you know, practice and, you know, have their band and work on a following. I think that still happens. But I think if you're popular in Michigan, you know it right away. So so that's good and bad maybe. But I do think that bands still do it.
Because time's short, I want to jump in and ask you this. So for me, like, when people are comfortable with their legacy, that's a sign of the character. And I think if you have a good relationship with your legacy, that shows that you're proud and you're happy with your work, right? And some people, I think, struggle with it their whole life and they don't manage to find peace and contentment. You seem to be incredibly content and happy with your legacy. Is that safe to say? And like everything that's kind of come from the Stray Cats and...
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I kind of always was.
So it's not something that's come with age with you. It's something you've always appreciated.
I think maybe with the other two a little more. I'm the drummer, and I'll bet you anything. Yes, Ringo, he'll say the same thing. You know, like I think it's a drummer's thing. I was always just happy to be there, proud to be there. These are my two friends from school. I think maybe more with a singer. I just think that it might take. You know, it's different with a drummer, I think, but like I love it. And
hi, Brian. How are you?
As we're speaking.
What? Well, I'm going to storm it.
There
come
you
on
go.
In.
Do you just ask the fantastic question, we're comfortable with the legacy of the Stray Cats? I said yes.
Yes. Continue on.
So there you go.
You think it's a drummer thing, right?
Well, I think drummers are always happy to be there. And I know I am. Well, that's the main thing for drummers. It's me. I'm happy to be here, me.
Tell me about your band with Sensible.
Well, Sensible's a you know, just a character. He's been around ever since we first came. He was one of the original, you know, people that came. And I just always stayed friendly with him. And then when we were looking for something to do one time and he came down and we played together. I think I was doing a trio thing, rockabilly. And he said, well, I'll play a few songs. And it just morphs into, you know, write a few together. And he's my friend.
Oh, I love when you were out with The Damned maybe 2 years ago and you got him on Instagram. And he's a character who I think needs to be on there because it's such a great platform for a colorful character like him. And you switched him onto it when you're on the road, didn't you? And so you're like posting together.
Yeah.
I loved it.
I think he was one of the original people on the internet, Sensible. I think he used to do like, you know, posts about his like wallpapering his house.
Don't believe him.
And did you work with Jerry Lee as well? Is that right?
Yes.
I mean, how was that? Is he as insane as they say?
Yeah, insane. I don't know if he remembered me from one day to the next. I can't say. But he was, you know, a couple times a night it would all click and it was on. And he's, you know, he's one of the main guys ever. I don't think any of us are having any conversation if Jerry Lee doesn't, you know, make those first records. No way.
Yeah, me and Jesse have talked a lot over the years, like Little Richard, Jerry Lee, Chuck Berry, obviously Elvis. Right. I mean, they're the architects, aren't they?
Yeah, positively. Eddie Cochran, Gene Vincent, Chuck Berry, Buddy Holly, Carl Perkins, Jerry Lee, positively. That handful of people, yeah.
Do you think the reason Stray Cats translated so well with such different pockets of the musical community is because that is the common thread, rock and roll? Mm. Like, it all comes back to that.
Yeah, positively. I think everyone has to know that, or you don't get really any further in this, you know, that you have to have some type of connection to that. You know, it's just, that's my personal theory. All roots lead back to Eddie Cochran. I think you have to kind of not sound like that or look like that, or but you have to have some type of connection to it.
Who is your ultimate all-time inspiration and hero?
Oh, Elvis Presley,
Elvis
for sure.
Is the one.
Yeah, yeah.
There's no mistaking that he's on the t-shirt there as well.
When I found his original recordings, that's when we all kind of really
took notice
of it all. Yeah.
Dude, I'm going to get out of your hair. Exactly. Thank you so much for your time. I'd love to do one of these again sometime when you're back in the UK or maybe if I'm in LA. And I want to do one with you too, Jenny.
Awesome.
Yeah. We make that happen?
Down like four flat tires.
Too high.